John Marshall here from Georgetown at the Otto J. Roush Center for the Cure of GI Cancers. One of the projects we are working on right now is to actually try and do a fairly regular review of the literature out there for GI tract cancers and try to pick each month or so some of the top new papers that have just been published. Not so much the abstracts, because we talk a lot about abstracts at ASCO and places like that. This is more of what's published and what's the really final data on that. And I picked four that I thought would be pretty interesting for us to review here at the end of August, Labor Day weekend coming up, Houston underwater, poor things. But I want to talk about these four abstracts. The first is a really fascinating one, in my opinion. It's called the Nordic 7 study. And this was a trial that had already been published. It was essentially chemotherapy using bolus 5-FU and oxaliplatin plus or minus cetuximab in a frontline setting. And this study had been negative. And then they said, well, let's wait. Let's do the RAS and BRAF enrichment. And the latest paper that was just published in British Journal of Cancer actually is the enrichment for RAS and BRAF. And surprisingly, this is really surprising to me, it is still a negative study. We have no idea why this is true. This is the right molecular profile. And the only real variable over other trials that have been done is simply the regimen of bolus 5-FU with oxaliplatin. So we don't really understand what this is about, but I think the takeaway lesson, and I still see a fair bit of this being done, is that maybe bolus 5-FU is not the best way to give 5-FU today, particularly in combination with other biologics. So Nordic 7, negative study, even when enriched for the right RAS and BRAF molecular subtypes when using cetuximab in the front line. I think that's important. The second one is another chemotherapy-based trial, and just so I get it right, this was published in JAMA Oncology just in July, just a month ago, and it's basically a pooled analysis of FOLFOX, ERI, BEV frontline regimens, and a bunch of studies that were done using that multiple drug frontline combination. And in fact, what this trial looked at is resectability rate and response rate and all of those good things. And I want to get this right for you, 69% response rate across this pooled analysis, 11 clinical trials to pull that forward, a very high surgical conversion rate of nearly 30%, 28% was the exact number, and an overall survival around 30 months. And of course, this is not with any molecular enrichment. So we keep pushing away FOLFOX, ERI, BEV as a frontline treatment choice because we say it's too spicy or all of that, even though we're doing it in pancreas cancer quite a bit. So I do think we need to take this analysis more seriously, particularly in that patient where you don't have molecular profiling back, you have bulky tumors and you need a response. This is a study or a way to go with that. Conversion therapy, this is a very interesting way to go for that. So I think maybe based on this analysis, we're underutilizing FOLFOX, ERI, BEV in the frontline setting. Third paper. This one is one of my faves because it looks at the use of aspirin and compares it to other antiplatelet drugs. And in point of fact, it showed that aspirin was good and the other antiplatelet drugs didn't add anything. I think that's really important. This is post-colon cancer, those who are taking aspirin, those who are not. Hazard ratio, 0.41, okay? So it's almost a must that if your patient can tolerate aspirin after a diagnosis of colon cancers, they should be on it. That's a dramatic positive hazard ratio. The other antiplatelet drugs did not have that benefit. I know most of us are doing that. Most of us are making that recommendation, but this is one more paper saying we should do it. European Journal of Cancer, a final paper published in May of this year. And the last one is actually in gastric cancer. And I think this to me is really complicated. And this is in HER2 positive gastric cancer. There were two papers published in Lancet Oncology looking at the use in second and third line of the fancier trastuzumab, the trastuzumab with the toxin attached to it, already approved in in breast cancer. So these are the Gatsby study and the Teresa study. Interestingly, the Gatsby study, which was a second-line clinical trial, was in fact negative, did not show benefit, but the third-line trial did with this kind of targeted therapy. So I don't know what to make of that. It's one argument is that maybe we shouldn't, like they do in breast cancer, do HER2 through lines of therapy. Maybe a break is in order somewhere there, like we do in some of the other targeted agents. Or maybe different drugs will come in here and have a different impact. So still very important to look at HER2 expression in your gastric cancer patients. And then I think we'll see more activity in second and third line, looking at new approaches for bringing in HER2 targeting in those downstream lines of therapy. So four papers, I think each of them are sort of influencing, some are practice changing, some you need to keep your nose out for, but I think important and worthy of noting, and hopefully we'll have another batch of papers to talk about in a month. John Marshall here at Georgetown at the Roush Center. Have a great fall.